Welcome to CPG, the Cannabis Packaged Goods Podcast, presented by Headset, the leading data and analytics company for the cannabis industry.
In this episode of the Cannabis Packaged Goods Podcast, I had a conversation with Joe Hodes, Chief Marketing Officer at Wana. We talk about his entrance into the cannabis industry, Wana's focus on product innovation, and how they deal with market fragmentation and expansion into these emerging markets. I hope you enjoy the conversation. So, Joe, we first met when you were at Dixie, and I think you've been in the cannabis business longer than Headset has been in existence, which is, you know, for us, about 5 years. So what drove that jump into cannabis, and was it really what you expected when you got involved?
Yeah, so I have been in the business longer than Headset. I started in technically in January 2014, although I was doing some consulting since 2010. And really, that was what kind of got me interested initially, was that consulting when I was with my ad agency. We took Dixie on as a client back then and just did a lot of research and did a lot of intercepts at dispensaries, and began to dawn on me that the people that were going into these dispensaries were not necessarily what I would stereotypically expect to be going into dispensaries. Now, I've always been a big fan of cannabis and of legalization, but it really, seeing the ages and the varieties and types of people that were going in to buy products, even at the medical level, was really interesting to me. So I kept in touch with the owners of Dixie for many years, and then eventually in January 2014 made that leap the first week of adult use legalization here in Colorado and became CMO of Dixie. And your immediate question is, was it what I expected? Gosh, you know, I don't know what I expected now. Yeah. Now that I think about it, I'm not really sure. I thought it was going to be fun and interesting, which it certainly has been. Right. I think what I didn't expect maybe is the emotional attachment that I have to the industry, the understanding of and appreciation for the plant and how it impacts people. Mm-hmm. I didn't really fully get that. I also didn't get, I got into it for the social change piece. I don't know that I realized, nor could anybody at the time, how vast and sweeping that could look, right? That, you know, as we go state by state, and as we look at expungement laws, and we look at social equity, and, you know, all of these issues that cannabis has around it, I don't know that I was necessarily thinking in those broader terms at the time. So a lot of good surprises, a lot of stuff that I knew was going to be challenging, like, you know, when there's negative stories about cannabis or regulatory challenges. But by and large, best move ever made in my career. So.
Yeah, that's great. I'd love to hear that. And it's always fantastic when, you know, the smart people come in from other industries and jump in. It just helps elevate this whole category in general. You mentioned 2014 in Colorado, just starting cannabis sales, you know, Colorado and Washington State, both.
We were first.
You were first.
All right, don't forget Seattle. That.
That's right. And a big reason why I actually moved up to Seattle from California originally was to see kind of some of that first day one, kind of what does adult use look like. But Colorado certainly was first to kind of open the doors to the adult use consumer. And 2014, I mean, that was a long time ago. So, you know, any big changes that you've noticed since that like first day? I'm sure there's tons, but anything like really notable?
Yeah, I'm laughing because, like, how much time do we have? Any big changes? I mean, I guess, you know, if you really think macro level, mm-hmm. there's the obvious, which is we now have, I can't even keep track anymore, number of states that are recreational or medically legal. So there's that on the regulatory level. And then I think it's also what I think has been interesting is just the acceptance by the consumer. And, you know, we saw that in Colorado, of course, as legalization took hold and people became more familiar with the products and they realized the sky wasn't falling. But we are now seeing it really spread throughout the country in terms of just that acceptance and understanding of the product. And it's actually becoming the thing that we said we wanted it to become, you know, 7 or 8 years ago, in terms of being, you know, no different than any other product, understanding the health benefits that it can offer. That level of education and knowledge for the consumer is really an interesting development that I didn't expect this soon.
Yeah. And you're absolutely right. There are a lot more states now, and, you know, states legalize, or there's some legislation that happens so frequently. At this point, sometimes I miss it. Like when you hear legislation being introduced in a new state, I mean, that was in 2014, if something like that happened, it would be the talk of the industry.
Huge. It's kind of right. Like,
oh, another one, which is you know, one of those nice problems to have. So you were at Dixie at the time, and then, you know, now you're at WANA. And you know, when I think of WANA, or when I, you know, think of edibles, I should say, I often think of WANA. I mean, synonymous, you know, one of the original, you know, producers at scale, I would say, of edible products. So I know Dixie, you know, was known for their beverages, I think, originally, but also their edibles. There were a number of edible products. So, you know, what did that transition look like? And how does that translate into some of your work at WANA today?
Well, I think the, you know, first of all, between Dixie and WANA, I had a couple of other little adventures in the industry that were very interesting and illuminating. And I relish both of those little side diversions. But if you take it straight from Dixie to WANA, obviously at the highest level, they're both edibles companies, right? So you have the same CPG, wholesale manufacturing kind of challenges and opportunities across both. But vastly different approaches to the market, different approaches to the consumer and the product set. So it has been beneficial to have an understanding of the market and frankly, the relationships that I was able to develop at Dixie that I was then able to take to WANA, definitely been beneficial to have that. But I think in terms of what we're doing at WANA, we have such an aggressive focus on innovation and on science and on education. And that really was not the main focus of Dixie. Dixie was focused on creating new products. Their innovation was expressed through new flavor profiles, new formats. WANA's is, okay, we know the gummy is a good delivery vehicle. How can we innovate within that delivery vehicle to bring forward the best products and the best results for the consumer? And so it's a little bit of a different approach than I think most, I'll call them CPG style cannabis companies take. And I love it. I think it's definitely the right way to do it. And I think that the consumer has responded by making us the number one edibles company in North America.
Yeah, absolutely. That is interesting. And it's great to see kind of different companies taking different approaches to the industry. You know, you mentioned some of the science, and one of the things that you know, WANA's done more recently, I believe, is kind of an investment in fast onset edibles. And kind of in the pre-show, we were talking a bit about this. I'm really excited about this this space. You know, I think the edible format is something that when I think about the legalization and future federal legalization and more people coming into the category, I think edibles are a pretty straightforward format for a lot of people. But I think there's a lot of history with edibles in different ways, like all the old brownie stories. You know, I remember in early legalization, Maureen Dowd with New York Times wrote that, you know, article where she took, you know, had too much and there's
chocolate.
Yeah, too much chocolate in this whole campaign around, you know, start low, go slow, you know, being mindful of it. And when I think about fast onset edibles, you know, it takes away a lot of that. And, you know, you have the effect much faster. You can still start low, but you get that sensation earlier. Much like, you know, you have a glass of wine, you might feel it, you know, within 10 to 15 minutes. You know, you're not waiting an hour like is so common with like more of a traditional edible format.
Yeah.
So I really love it. I love this, that this is happening. And now there's been a lot of different types of categories where it's like tinctures, sublinguals, where people say, well, this acts a little faster, you know. So how, with what WANA is doing, you know, I really do feel like you guys are investing in the science behind it. So can you kind of tell me a little bit more about, you know, what makes the fast onset edibles actually fast onset with WANA?
Yeah, I'd love to. And thank you for bringing that up, because it is really a big focus for us right now. And in fact, we are this summer launching several new SKUs. We've got a number of new products that we're bringing to the table that I can tell you about maybe in a few months from now, but some of which use that fast onset technology. It took us several years to develop it. And as you pointed out, early on, there were companies that would say, well, we do fast acting, or we have a fast acting product. And it was either based on the format, like a sublingual or a beverage, or it was a quote-unquote nano emulsion technology. I started hearing about nano emulsion technologies back when I was with Dixie, so, you know, six, seven years ago. But they weren't to the point where they are now, and so that's why it took us 2 years. So as other companies were coming out with their nano emulsion products, we were actually still focused on doing our research, and we were finally able to get to a point where we had a product that we felt so confident about that we were able to bring it to market. And what was important to us is that it had the effect that we were promising it would have. And that was really, there were three things here. One, fast onset. So works in 5 to 15 minutes for most people. Two, rapid offset. So many people don't want a 6 hour experience with an edible. I mean, if you're going to spend all day at a concert, an outdoor festival, maybe that's great. But for some people, you don't really want 6 or 7 hours, right? So that 2 to 3 hour offset, another important piece. And then lastly, the fact that because of the way we encapsulate it, it actually maintains the delta 9 molecule structure versus what happens in most cases with edibles, which is when you digest it, there's actually an enzyme in the liver that converts it to 11-hydroxy. That's really what gives people the sometimes the very heavy edibles effect that sometimes people don't like, right? So we were able to create this product that solved so many of the issues for the consumer, and the consumer responded. So while there were many products on the market prior to us, we were the first, I think, to really say to the consumer, here's what we're going to deliver, and we actually delivered it.
That's amazing. And you're right. Those are points that I didn't even think about. The beyond the fast onset, the fast offset, right? You know, you have a glass of wine and kind of gets out of your system in a few hours versus a long 12 hours or something like an edible might do. And then the difference between the 11-hydroxy and the delta 9, I do think, you know, anecdotally you hear people say, well, edibles, you know, same effect, and it's maybe a heavier effect. And then with flower-based products, there's like more nuanced effect, you know, with different consumers where they may say, well, this type of sativa doesn't make me as sleepy or whatever. And so to bring some of that capability into the edibles category is pretty exciting because it's a whole new way to position. I feel like, you know, edibles, you get, you know, flavors and formats, and that's great. You get potency, so you can have, you know, 10 milligram or 5 milligram or, you know, 2.5 milligram. That's kind of where the innovation has stopped, you know. But this is, it's got to be the future of like the edible category. So I
would have to believe that, you know, everyone is going to eventually come out with a Me Too product. They're going to be newer technologies that start to proliferate in the market. And we're seeing a little bit of that, but I think that what that means for us is that it becomes more acceptable for edibles for people to experiment with edibles. And I think the whole Maureen Dowd example that you started with, that begins to fade away as people realize, okay, this is something I can manage. I can have that 2.5 milligrams, that 5 milligrams. I can feel it quickly. I can begin to titrate my dose appropriately. And you take away that fear factor. I think that's good for the industry as a whole, not just Wana.
Yeah. And those new consumers coming in, right? Like flower still dominates sales. But flower is a complex product for a new consumer to come in, and you're buying the flower, you got to grind the flower, you got to find a way to ingest the flower, which is maybe making a pre-roll out of it or having some device like a vaporizer. Right. That's a lot, you know. But a nice pack of edibles, people are, you know, understand how a gummy, you know, what it tastes like, and if they know.
All right, so I take it from here and I put it in my mouth, right?
Exactly, right. Totally. So I do think that it's good for the industry, and I think you'll see like good growth of the category. And I would be, you know, not. I would be unsurprised if more brands didn't try to invest in the science as consumers get savvier about asking for it. And I think there's some education yet that probably needs to happen with consumers that this is what they should be for when they're considering, you know, purchasing cannabis. You know, speaking of these facets, these ends in particular, I noticed that they're named after cocktails. So you've got strawberry margarita, you got pina colada. So what kind of drove some of that decision, and how's the consumer reception been of that?
Well, you know, of course, I'm a little biased, but I think consumer reception has been great. Those initial three SKUs that we launched in March of 2020, just before the pandemic, really, got into the top 10 of all edible SKUs in Colorado within a couple of months, and they've remained there. So consumers really like them. And I think what's great about the drink, and I'll tell you why we did it, but I think what's great about the drink flavors is that it's familiar, yet it's interesting, right? So there's not a lot of peach Bellini gummies out there. Right. There's not a lot of pina colada gummies out there. So the flavor profile, I think, is really appealing to the consumer. But secondarily, what we're trying to communicate with this product and that we continue to push on is this idea that because of its duration and its fast onset, it is a happy hour gummy. It can be a replacement for that, you know, 4 or 5 o'clock happy hour cocktail that you might have with somebody. And, you know, by 7 o'clock, it's, you know, it's kind of ramping down and you're good, just like a happy hour. So the drink kind of went with that, but I think it's also the social element. I like to talk about these gummies in the context of saying it's the first really social edible where it was funny. We were talking in and amongst ourselves on the sales team, and our chief revenue officer said that he had brought some samples to some folks. I think he was in California. And he said, we all quicked up before we went to the restaurant. I said, wait a minute, quicked up. I'm like, oh, I like that expression. So, you know, the idea of, you know, you have your gummy, you walk in the restaurant, 15 minutes later, you're feeling great. You have a great meal. By the time you're done, you're starting to feel the, you know, kind of come down. So it's a really good social tool that I think edibles, by and large, as a reputation, just haven't had as being social in terms of their use.
Yeah, totally. Totally. I like that. And when you can associate it with a verb? Quicked up.
It's a verb, good. I think.
Yeah, it's good. That's good marketing if everyone's saying that, right? Associate with the brand. But yeah, the flavors remind me recently in my house, for some reason, we had the Sugar Fina, which is like a candy. There's a regular candy, not a cannabis candy.
Okay.
They make some candies that are like pina colada gummies and some others like named after.
Oh, really?
After drinks. Yeah. It's pretty interesting. I think it's just they're positioned as like a high end candy, and somehow they ended up at our house. But they're pretty good. I haven't had a chance to try yours yet, because I'm in Washington here. Unfortunately, I don't think they're sold here yet, but I know in California and markets like Colorado and some of our team members have had them. And I was quick to ask, you know, how quick was it? Did it work? And the feedback was, yeah, absolutely, which is great to hear.
Nice.
There's been a lot of, to your point, a lot of different kind of claims around fast acting, mostly around the beverages or the sublinguals. So I'm super excited, obviously, if it's not coming across. Like I think this innovation, and you know, that's what this podcast is looking to capture, is like these kind of stories, like this, you know, fast acting edibles may just be the standard, you know, in years from now. And you know, that's
well, and hopefully if it is the standard years from now, then Wana has gone 10 steps beyond that, and we're doing the next thing is going to be the standard 20 years from now.
That's right.
That's the plan.
Yeah. Well, I mean, speaking of getting ahead, I also noticed that you guys are moving away from high fructose corn syrup, you know, in your edibles, and, you know, that's great. You know, I think, you know, a lot of people are looking for more natural, more organic ingredients. So is that something that is an example of you guys just being ahead of the curve, or is that something that like customers have been specifically saying, like, hey, I would buy this if it didn't have corn syrup in it? Or is it just, you know, something that, you know, Wana is looking down the field and saying, you know what, consumers are going to start demanding this. We need to get in front of this.
All of the above, actually. And I would say that, you know, for us, it was always the one thing where, like, you know, we use great ingredients, great quality of everything. We don't like the fact we have the corn syrup in there. However, much like I was saying about the 2 years of research that it took to get the quick onset technology kind of locked down, same thing went for replacing the corn syrup. We've spent such time and love and care in creating our gummy formulations that we had to find a replacement that didn't change the flavor, didn't change the texture and the consistency, didn't change the reliability of the product, because, you know, cannabis is a finicky oil. It doesn't mix well with a lot of stuff, right? So we had to make sure that all of that worked really well, and that just took a long, long time. We started that process, you know, years ago as well. So you know, we always felt like it was something we knew we wanted to do, and not just because consumers were telling us, although that's an important part, but because we inherently knew that we wanted more organic and natural ingredients in our product. I mean, it was already packed in, which meant it was vegan and gluten-free, and, you know, it had about a lot of other great qualities to it. So that was kind of the last piece of that we wanted to get in place, but it just took a while. And I'm so glad that we've done it, and people really are excited about the new formula.
Yeah, that's great. I'd imagine it's just another kind of differentiation point between other, you know, brands out there, when you can point to, hey, we use, you know, this type of ingredient versus ingredient, and getting consumers savvier about, you know, asking, you know, for what they're looking for, I guess, specifically. So, you know, one of the we've been talking a lot about edibles, and I believe Wana does some tinctures as well. I'm sure, I mean, are you guys thinking about other formats, or is it, you know, edibles are where you excel and you're just going to keep innovating within that, you know, category of cannabis? Or are you guys thinking about, you know, potentially some other formats beyond the edibles and tinctures that you have today?
Well, our focus on innovation really does revolve around what is the best delivery vehicle for cannabis. And that's how we look at, that's how we look at gummies. We make gummies, but we're not a candy maker. We're not a CPG company. We're a company that says, what are the elements of the plant that we can express through the best and most efficient delivery vehicle that happens to be gummies for us right now. We have other products, by the way. We have tincture, we have tarts. We did have vapes for a while. So we have done other products, but we keep coming back to the gummy as the best delivery vehicle. And frankly, what the consumer also really wants, right? When you look at the edible market, last data I looked at, well, you, part of your data guy, you know this, right? 80%+ of the edibles market is gummies, right? So the consumer is saying we want gummies. So our focus is going to be less on, can we create 27 new formats, and more on what are the ways that we can begin to differentiate based on other maybe rare cannabinoids, our terpene formulations, you know, what are other nutraceutical and grass ingredients that would attenuate the effects that we're looking for. So more use case type product development. That's really where our innovation is heading. And if gummy is the right vehicle, great. If we feel like it needs a different vehicle because the gummy doesn't work for whatever the reason, then we'll find that vehicle. But it's always about the cannabis first.
Right, right. Well, that's a great way to look at it. So speaking of tarts, I noticed products like your mixed berry tarts are available in markets like Colorado, and you have other markets like Arizona where products that might not be available in Colorado, like mango sativa sour gummies, which may or may not be in Colorado, and you know better than I do, certainly. But there's some fragmentation, and you know, we didn't really get into that about this industry and the nuance of the industry, but just in your role as CMO, how does that impact like product marketing when you have so much fragmentation and different formats or different SKUs maybe available in different regions? I'd imagine that's an undertaking.
It is tough. It's a bear. And there's some things that we have to do because they're regulatorily required. So our packaging in Florida, vastly different than our packaging in Colorado, because that's what law requires, right? So I don't know if you've seen Florida packaging, but it's pretty much black and white. There's no colors, no images, nothing. Our gummies are actually clear, or we'll call them translucent. Mm-hmm. They're not allowed to have color. So so you have that on one extreme, and then you got Colorado where we have our full set of products and our packaging is really the ideal version of our packaging. So some of those things are required regulatorily, and they are a chore to, every time we launch a new product, if I want to take our quick SKUs and I want to put them into 10 of our new markets, I have to create new labels for each of those markets to get them there, right? Some of it is on the marketing side. One of the things, and I've been with Wana since March of 2020, one of the things I did when I got here is I said, let's stop focusing and wasting so much time and energy on saying, okay, if we're going to run this ad in Arizona, it's got to have the exact Arizona packaging, or, you know, I said, you know, we're trying to get across the brand and the products as a whole. We know that it's not the right packaging for Arizona maybe, but, and I'm just using that as an example, but the consumer, as long as we're not saying we offer a 500 milligram mango product and it's actually a 100 milligram apple product, you know, I don't want to create that kind of confusion. But as long as in general, we're just talking about gummies and our differentiators in those products, I'm not worried if it's a, you know, the bottle says a 5 milligrams, you know, versus a 10 milligram. So that was one of the things that I really kind of focused on, because we could just spend all day trying to get the exact right thing in every single market otherwise.
Yeah, no, the fragmentation in the industry is so wild that we have to navigate it. And yeah, from a marketing perspective, not only, you know, marketing channels limited to the cannabis industry, but when you have to deal with, you know, an ad in Arizona versus another market and making sure it's, I could see how that could get quite complex, and then packaging and the rest. So speaking of fragmentation, I do believe Wana was one of the earlier brands to develop relationships with license holders in other markets, and those production facilities and licensing the Wana brand and some of the products that Wana was known for into those markets. So, you know, there's also a lot of I think momentum right now in some of the emerging markets, like on the East Coast, like Florida, for example, of kind of these multi-state ad brands that have done really well in markets like Colorado or California, and saying, okay, can we bring these brands, you know, out to our markets, you know, brands like Wana. So how do you guys look at the world? You know, are you still looking at licensing and, you know, working directly in certain markets and licensing in other markets and, you know, partnering in even other markets? I'm sure it's a lot to navigate.
Yes, it is. And we've chosen to go what we call like an asset light approach. So we have everything from just a straight licensing up through more of a contract manufacturing. But what we don't do is we're not building out our own facilities and we're not getting our own licenses currently in those markets. So it's allowed us to expand, I think, a little more rapidly. So as of today, we're in 11 states plus 9 provinces in Canada. We'll probably be, I'd say, in 15 states by the end of the year, which I believe gives us, if not the largest, certainly one of the largest footprints for a brand in North America. And but, you know, that said, it's still a challenge. Like, each market is an individual partnership. There's a variety of different regulational challenges in each market, and each partner is different, right? It's like having a relationship in 11 different states. That's not easy to navigate. So, you know, it is certainly something that we focus on. But I think one of the great things that we did that I noticed the minute I started working at Wana is we have a team of people focused on out-of-state expansion. I think many companies don't realize what it takes to actually create really strong SOPs, to implement them, to follow up with QA and making sure that everything's being done the exact way that you need it to be done. And then to build that relationship as well. That is a big, big task. So we have a team that actually focuses on that. And that's something that I think is often overlooked as people are building out their organizations. They just think, well, we'll just have, you know, so-and-so license it in this market and they can produce it and do all that. It's not that easy.
Yeah, no, certainly it's not. And you mentioned Canadian provinces, and I know, you know, you guys are working with Indiva there in Canada.
Yeah.
And, you know, getting into those 9 provinces, you know, with Canada, it's been pretty interesting to watch because they were pretty slow on the edibles track, like with the legalization, you know, started, and edibles were prohibited for the first, you know, year and a half, 2 years until the 2.0 products, as they call them, even though in the U.S. here, in markets like Colorado, is very much a 1.0 product. You know, is there any differences with the Canadian market versus U.S. markets, or is it Canada's almost just like a Florida where the packaging is pretty restrictive and, you know, marketing might be more restrictive?
Vastly different in that. So in Canada, we're only allowed to have 10 milligrams per package, right? So everything is packaged in those individual foil wrap packages. Two, they have 2 different kinds of packaging. So they have the packaging that the product is actually in, and then they have beauty packaging, which allows for a little bit more marketing, a little bit more color to it. But the packaging that the product goes into, the consumer brings home with them, is actually very plain. It has, you know, a color and then a logo, and that's really pretty much it. So that creates a different in-store experience. It creates a different consumer experience because they're not buying a 100 milligram bottle of 10 gummies or 20 gummies in some cases. They're buying a foil pack of 2 gummies at a time. However, the one thing that is not different is the preference for gummies in that market. We have a 50%, almost across the board, 50% share of the market in Canada right now with our gummies. And it's, you know, it's a massive success in Canada, due in large part to our partners at Indiva. But also, I think it was the first time we were able to demonstrate that our brand and our products do translate internationally to another country. And the consumer there has been really, really receptive to the Wana product.
Fantastic to hear. You know, so much of, I feel like building a mainstream kind of brand in cannabis requires like scale. Like, it's really hard to do that if you're just in Colorado or you're just in California.
Absolutely.
But if you can be in North America, you know, if you can be in, you know, the US and Canada, like legal markets that exist today, that definitely has got to give you, you know, some significant advantages. Well, Joe, this has been, just a great conversation. Anything we should look forward to? I know you mentioned maybe some products that, in 6 to 9 months from now that you guys can talk about, but anything in the near-term horizon that people can look forward to?
Yeah, I'll promise you this. I'll talk about those new products in about 3 months, not 6 to 9 months.
Okay,
so
I like that.
I'll definitely look forward to talking about those. And then in terms of the near term, we have several new SKUs. So our original SKUs of Quick products were 5 milligram products. These new SKUs are going to be 10 milligram versions of our Quick product, and new drink flavors that we're kind of excited about too. So those will be coming up in Colorado in, let's say, 2 to 3 weeks. We're going to start selling those. And then we're also expanding that Quick product line to a lot of new states, Oregon, which I know you live very close to. So, just might want to think about that.
Yeah. Summertime, a little road trip planning here.
Michigan, Oklahoma, we're in California with them now. So we got a lot of new markets where we're going to be taking that Quick product. So I'm excited about that. And then, like I said, these other products are completely, you've not seen anything like them yet. So I'm super excited about those and I can't wait to talk about them.
Well, fantastic. I'll have to check back in 3 months, and I'll definitely have to find my way down to Oregon, if not California, sooner than later to get to try those fast onsets firsthand.
Please. And let me know what you think.
Will do. Well, thanks, Joe. It's been a pleasure, and congrats on everything, and looking forward to catching up with you in the months ahead.
Thank you, Si. I appreciate it. And I did want to add just a real quick anecdote that you probably don't even know, is that you may recall back that, first year when we met each other, you guys invited me and a bunch of other folks up to Seattle to do like a Leafly roundtable advisory board thing. And we had cocktails at a restaurant or at the bar at the office building. I don't know what it was, but I ended up talking with Mike Lord from LiveWell. That was the first time I'd met Mike and didn't really know LiveWell that well. And I just wanted you to know. Yeah, right. Great, great Colorado brand. And I just wanted you to know that Mike and I and the entirety of the LiveWell team became super tight, and that became a great relationship for Dixie, which I've then carried over to Wana as well. And so I appreciate the fact that in those early days we were able to make those kinds of relationships happen. So thank you.
Yeah, you got it. And those are some great days. And that's I like to tell people there's never been a better time to be in cannabis, and I think that still carries through. There's still all sorts of great connections to make, and great brands being developed, and great people coming into the space. And definitely, I've known you longer than most. Even I know I mentioned Headset in the beginning, but our days started back with Leafly. When you guys were on the executive advisory board, really helping us at Leafly kind of understand, the direction of the platform and what works and what doesn't work. And that's invaluable for our success there as well. So thanks for all that too. So
yeah.
Well, now with the pandemic ending, hopefully sooner than later, and travel opening up, I look forward to maybe getting drinks with you again in the near future.
That sounds great. I would welcome that. So thanks, Ty. I appreciate you having me.
Thanks, Joe. We'll talk to you soon.
All right. Take care.
Thanks for joining CPG, the Cannabis Packaged Goods Podcast. For more information on Headset, visit headset.io.